to open the meeting? That's
second.
Okay.
Second. All in favor?
So, aye.
Okay.
You have to push the button.
Oh.
There you go.
Should I do all of them?
Other of those are not good.
No? Okay.
Hey, Tim, did you get my text? I did, I'm sorry. Okay.
So does anyone wanna maybe act as, wanna like be the chair until, or if Valerie doesn't come? Somebody wanna kind of kick that off for tonight?
Valerie's out of state.
So she's, I
She's definitely not coming.
She's out of state.
Oh, out, oh, okay.
Yeah, no, I can do that. I'm obviously just punting, but unless someone else
No, I think you're good.
Feels they have
You're sitting in the middle of the table, so
You're right, I did choose the best seat.
Location, location, location.
Yeah, right place at the right time. I'm running this meeting now, thank you. Alright.
Did you bring it out?
Dang it.
Okay, so, one thing we could possibly do, if somebody wants to make a motion, is to approve the minutes from the last meeting.
I move that we approve the minutes from the last meeting.
Alright.
Second.
Yeah, we got a second, we get a third.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Awesome. Okay.
So,
So it looks like we have a guest here.
We do.
Alright.
Do we have any,
Announcements?
No, more just anything that was, that we need to follow from last meeting. So we have a clerk now, we have video, paper. Was there anything else? We did appoint a chair, but who's not here? Convenient. So is there anything else before moving on to new, we basically have to establish an agenda.
Right.
Because we're the one.
Right.
Cool. So can anything, anybody think of anything that was on the call?
Can I think of any loose ends that we have before we get to new?
Great. So do we want to move on to a discussion of whatever is being
Are you running it or is she running?
I'm in an advisory position, and she's someone who's acting for, as chair for the first time probably ever, so I'm just helping.
Yeah.
It's a collaborative group.
Just wanted to know. Yeah, so last village board meeting, I was able to find that a law that Bernie Sanders passed in 31 years ago, so what is that? And the law was, it limited return of the deposits to 2 weeks. It capped security deposits at 1 month, and it punished landlords with a monetary fee if they didn't return security deposits. So I was really curious as to why the board supported Bernie Sanders, specifically Dennis, but didn't support this law. And I didn't really get an answer, so.
One, I'm not sure when you asked me that question.
Well, I'm asking it now.
Number two, asking me to blankly support anything that Bernie Sanders ever did is not really a serious question.
I'm not asking
okay.
you to blankly
no, but
support
you're telling
I'm
me
saying if,
I
some, if a tenant voted for you,
so
they
you're having a civil conversation here.
You're interrupting me.
All right, okay, I'm just going to pause this for a second because this isn't. He's a board member, he's our liaison, he's not technically part of this council. And we are, I'm a member of this council. So
you don't live here.
Could we introduce ourselves?
I don't live here.
I do
live
here.
You do not live in the village.
I do not. I do not, which is why I'm an advisory non-voting role. So
you're not invited to the table either.
And that's also
you invited me
to the meeting. But in the interest of accomplishing something, if we can keep this conversation civil,
I was civil
and not attacking and not interrupting,
he interrupted
and if
me.
We could keep it focused, if we want to discuss the actual legislation that's being proposed and we can talk about the actual merits and not about who, what elected official supports what other elected official, like this is not a council of elected officials right now. So if we could just kind of keep this conversation focused. So if you want to present what you're proposing and
right.
actually discuss the points of your legislation, this like argument is not productive in any way. So,
it was productive for me.
Well, that's irrelevant. So
I'm sorry.
I'm going to interrupt.
Sure.
Hi, Celeste. My name is Robin Ward. I'm a resident in the village. I'm a homeowner. I'm a member of the council, but this is my first meeting here. So I'm just introducing myself to you. So I'd like to know, what is the rule, the law? You mentioned 2 weeks to return security, cap security at 1 month. What was the third thing? 1 week something?
It was a penalty if you didn't return it. What I was trying to say before I was interrupted is that the law that I wrote that this is based on, that was based on 2 years of me volunteering as an attorney to do free tenant work, is based off of Bernie Sanders' law, which was passed 31 years ago and had no negative effects. I think that's important.
I'd like to know more about what are the details of it.
Well, Dennis was forwarded a copy of it. He could probably send it to you. He's on this board.
Yes, and that's great, and I will certainly ask for that. Thank you.
So you think it's important that we talk about that?
I think it's important that we find... I'm sorry, I wasn't finished talking yet. Thank you.
I didn't say anything.
I think it's important that we... I'll be straightforward. I'm having a bit of a reaction to you rolling your eyes so much. So, yes, I think it's important to consider rules that are appropriate for New Paltz. I don't think that the fact that Bernie Sanders' name... I'm a huge Bernie fan, absolutely. But I don't think the fact that it has Bernie Sanders' name on it makes it carte blanche that it will fit for us. I also don't know what the policy is for adopting new rules along this line, what the process is. And so I think that that's a step that we need to take a look at.
Sure. What we're looking to do is come up with a set of suggestions that we can then bring back to the village board and do, say, this is what the LTRC believes would be productive and what they support, and then as a board we would discuss it. We've already discussed Celeste's legislation as a board, and it did not get very far.
Okay.
So this is an attempt to really flesh out what can be supported, bring something back to the board,
Right.
So that's why I invited Celeste to come to
that. Right. And I did see the thing in the minutes from before about the message being sent to the board, and I was here at the last village meeting where the message was delivered. So, okay, good. I just wanted to be brought back up to speed.
I had got a phone call last week through the tree service, and I was a reporter named Jacob. They didn't leave a last name on to interview me, but because I'm on this council. And we ended up talking, and he wanted to know how I got on the council, and then he pretty much quickly, you know, went over to the tenant petition, I guess it is, or the rules. And my feeling about it was that, well, first of all, he said that I guess the Landlord-Tenant Council is completely opposed to it. I said, no, I don't believe that that was the case. I think we sent a message to the village board through Dennis that we were not prepared to comment on it, support it at this time. And no, you said that you were opposed to it. I said, no, I really don't believe that we did. So I got off the phone, because I know many, many times when you're interviewed, through nothing malicious, that you're misquoted and your point of view is not conveyed properly, and so it's just probably sometimes best not to talk about it. My feeling was, and I think we touched on this last week or last month, I think you're redefining the wheel or reinventing the wheel, because a lot of the stuff that goes on between landlords and tenants is handled in the lease. I mean, you don't have to put in your lease that you're going to, or there doesn't have to be a law in the village that you're going to provide heat. That is just, I'm sure that's handled someplace else. A lot of things about like subletting, that is up to the individual landlord and tenant. I know that some landlords don't allow it, I do. That's in your lease. If you can sublet, it's in your lease. As far as your security deposit, what I collect as a security deposit is not what somebody else collects, and that again is in the lease. If the person doesn't want to sign my lease and rent my property, they are free to go elsewhere and find a lease that is more, you know, amenable to them and fits in with what they feel is fair to them. So I don't really know why that we need to have the law passed that is, you know, very punitive in most respects to the landlord when all these things are handled elsewhere.
Well, the heat thing, just for the record, I mean, there. Okay, to my memory, first of all, like I thought, okay, when we just said we can't support it as written, I know that there were specific things that we pointed out that we were like, I'm in favor of this, I like this, as I remember. Mm-hmm. And then in addition to that, I guess this is kind of getting into this more specifics of it, but we're just speaking strictly about the security deposit issue right now, right? Because if we start bringing in other things like heat and stuff, then
I thought we were discussing the laws that they propose it, and there were things in there that, you know, landlords will be punished monetarily if they don't provide what they promise. Well, that goes without saying. That's in your lease, and you know, if you promise that you're going to plow, you have to plow. If you promise you're going to mow the lawn, you need to mow the lawn. If it is an assumption, I think, that you're going to provide heat in a building, and that will go elsewhere. It doesn't have to be a local law. That is going to be that's just a law, you know. So I don't know why all this stuff has to be addressed in a separate set of rules and laws.
Gotcha.
So I just wanted to say hi. I'm Kenny. It's nice to meet you, everybody. I know I've met a bunch of you already. So I just wanted to take a moment and just comment that, you know, as many of you know, I'm very pro-tenant. I'm very, you know, trying to find a way that we can coexist more. And I just want to say that at times you, Celeste, give a defensive vibe, and I totally get where that's coming from. I just want you to know that you do have allies in this community who want to see the same thing. So I just, at least just me personally speaking, just me, I just would like to be able to have like a very cohesive conversation about these issues. I've looked up and down your website, you know, I've looked, you know, about searching different properties and seeing the information you've collected. And there's some parts that you really want to create like an enforcement or, you know, local law really supporting state and federal regulations. So I'm just wanting to say that there are some parts of what you wrote that I'm very into. You know, some parts that I think could be tweaked, but.
Can I speak now?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, so the reason that Jacob said that, or whoever it is that Dennis said, and I quote, "The Board of Tenant Relations looked at it and they unanimously opposed the law." So that's why I got and Jacob got the message that they were against it. So if Dennis didn't accurately represent what happened here, then I think that should be stated. We're not rewriting the wheel on this. 30 other states already have limits on security deposits. Everything in this law isn't something I just imagined up. I researched for a long time what other states are doing and what other cities are doing, and I brought the best of it. If you're wondering why I feel very defensive here, it's because during my lunch break today, I have a full-time job, and during my lunch break today, I had to file 6 tenant lawsuits for free, of course. So, and one of them, okay, 4 of them were roommates. They never got their security deposit back. One of them lived alone. One of them was a foreign exchange student, and he found somebody to sublet, and the landlord took the sublet and took the money from the sublet and then kept the $2,100 security deposit. Now, this is somebody that was a foreign exchange student, and he told me that he's working, you know, for less than minimum wage in a kitchen to save money. And he's on the other side of the country right now, and he had no way of getting this money back. If I wasn't representing him for free, he had no way. The landlord originally said they'd return the security deposit, and then it just never happened. They stopped answering the phone calls. Would you say that that is an abusive practice and something we can all agree, like those type of landlords, those shouldn't be, that's who we're targeting. Can we all agree on that?
Yes, but can
I just say something else? So the person we were suing is Valerie Irwin, and this board unanimously elected her the chair. And then you had it done in the village board meeting. That's why I don't trust you, because Tim Rogers knew that we already had 5 lawsuits pending against her before she was even on this board. I gave him copies of those lawsuits before she was put on this board. So I want to know why someone that's being sued by 5 different groups of tenants, now 11 different groups of tenants, and next week 16, which I've been working my ass off for, I want to know why you made her head of this board if you really care about tenant rights.
Celeste, can I ask you a question?
Can he answer?
Well, okay.
Well, that's kind of up to us, for one. Because again, he's our liaison.
please.
You're not the chair. You're running.
Unless you have no right to walk into our meeting and speak over everybody.
You can't.
I'm not speaking over everybody.
You are.
Why did you elect her head of this committee? You knew we were suing her.
We're listening to her.
For one, I would like to say that the key word there is pending. Also, none of us were made aware of any kind of legal whatever that was going on before.
Well, the mayor knew.
And, like I said, the
And Alex knew.
Okay, you need to stop, because we can ask you to leave this meeting, and we'll be completely justified in doing so. If you're gonna talk over council members, you can't do it. You can't do it. So, the key word there is pending, because we don't know anything about these cases. We don't know if they're valid. You're saying they are, but, you know, we don't know you that well, for one. And we don't know how valid, and maybe all of these cases against her are valid, and that's all going to come out in the wash. But as far as her ability to be a functional chair in this council, we made our best decision, one, because she's somebody who's willing to do it, not to mention our meetings are videotaped now, which means if there's any case for her abusing her power as chair, she can, like that, be removed by the village board. If for perhaps all of these cases that have been filed against her, and again, we can't really talk about legal stuff like that because I'm not a lawyer, you are, so you know that there's a lot of issues about discussing court cases on camera in a public meeting. So those things will be discussed as they come, but given what we knew and what we know at the time, that is not justification for making that decision. So again, like I said, these court cases are pending. That's something we have to cross when we get to that bridge.
That's one person's opinion. Can I hear from the other board members if they feel misled knowing that Alex and the mayor had copies of 5 lawsuits pending against Valerie Irwin from tenants in this village? Can I hear from individual members? I think that
Celeste,
is fair.
In the interest of time, let me just
she
tell
disclosed
you right
all
now,
of that to us.
Valerie completely disclosed that to us last time, and everybody still felt she was the best.
And she offered to recuse herself.
And
if
she
there
offered
was
to
any,
herself.
Well, if there was any
she
issue
was,
that she would be.
She has, so for those of you that are like, I don't know if there's any merit, she has 7 previous cases where tenants have filed against her for not returning security deposits, and they won. And I just got that in 5 minutes at the court case. No one here thought to look that up, and you still think that she deserves to be head of this chair, and you wonder why I come in here defensive?
Well, landlord-tenant disputes are fairly common, and I mean, I understand you're being upset at your clients having been abused, that's your opinion. But the thing is, it's going to be handled in the court, and they're in the court all the time. So why is this a big earth-shattering situation when a landlord sues a tenant sues a landlord, or vice versa? You know, you owe me money, you didn't pay rent, you broke something, you owe me money, I didn't break anything, I want my security back. It goes to court. I don't understand why it's so upsetting to you, actually, I guess.
I also did want to say, just for the record, I'm basically in if you look at the situation that Valerie is in, without saying anything, I am basically a tenant who is, you know, on the opposite end of the spectrum. So it's kind of like there are people coming from everywhere. And I know it's like I can't, you know, I'm not going to discuss whatever legal situations I have right now, but it's just, that was just sort of separate from what made her, what qualified her to be a good representative as a landlord, what we thought, in our opinion. And it didn't have anything to do with her legal.
She also had a lot of experience serving on other village boards in the past. You know, it's not like she just walked in off the street and has never served the village before. She has served the government in the past. She has experience with these things. If we find that she's doing anything unscrupulous, we can handle it at a later date. But we're not going to assume that she's guilty because you have a lawsuit.
What about the 7 lawsuits that have already been adjudicated by a town judge that said that she withheld security deposits wrongly? Do you know better than the town judge?
Why would
you
say they know better or
the town judge?
Thank you, Amanda. So I just want to say I was not here last meeting, so I did not vote, but that's my loss, you know. But I'd be interested to see the ones that you're referencing that have already been decided. You know, if you have like some links or something, I would love to see that. But I have to agree that, you know, the cost of doing business is sometimes getting sued. But if it comes out that a judge finds in favor of these tenants and there's like a real decision on there, that would make me rethink all of this, you know? But I'm not gonna say just on this, because there are frivolous lawsuits all the time, we know it. But if something comes out of it, or the ones that you say have already been decided on, I would love to see it, you know, be able to like read what was going on with that. But.
And also, I just wanna just say that we're still not discussing what we should be discussing. Like, right now we're discussing the merit of our decision of who we made chair. That is not what you're here to discuss with us. And I know you're saying that's why you felt offensive, but at the same time, like, that doesn't matter to me. Whether or not you agree with who we decided to make chair because you happen to be in court against them, that doesn't mean that there's not other people who still want to discuss the merits and the improvements to be made to the legislation if we want to actually get something passed. And I liked some of the stuff in it, and there was actually something in the previous version I liked that was taken out that I'd like to see put back in regarding credit checks. I thought that was a really great component of the previous draft. And I was really upset that it was taken out. So I feel like if we can really just refocus back into the actual legislation that's being proposed and we can actually get something good out of this that will pass the board, I feel like that's where we should refocus this discussion.
You know, Valerie's business dealings have nothing to do with the fact that we elected her to be chair. She, as Dennis said, she's been on other boards. She's a capable person. She's organized. And the way she runs her business has nothing to do with any decisions that we make.
I can see why she would be concerned that it would, because it's an issue of agenda, for, you know, individual agenda. And I can understand that. That's why there's people from different, there's people representing tenants, there's people representing landlords, and there's people representing, you know, residents who are neither tenants nor landlords. So we're trying to cover all the bases of different possible agendas, so I can understand why agendas are an issue. However, I don't think an ad hominem attack right now is the way to go, and I think that getting back on mission of looking at what you want to accomplish instead, I mean, I understand questioning the legitimacy of some decisions based on what you're saying. I wasn't here last week. I don't know about that vote. And I don't know about the lawsuits either. But at the same time, I'd like to hear more about what you want to achieve, because I don't think criticizing an individual is what you want to achieve. I think what you want to achieve is good laws for tenants. So can you tell us more about what you want to do?
Want me to tell you about the law?
Well, what do you want us to do here? What I mean, we're here to listen, and I'd like to know more about what you would like us to do.
Well, I guess we could go step by step if we're going to be constructive. Does anyone here have an issue with there being a 2-week limit for returning security deposits? Is the law in Ithaca, New York?
Is this the, okay? But this is how we're doing things. Are we gonna do that and then vote on it?
Well, no. I mean, we're not. I mean,
I just didn't understand.
I think
what is the purpose of this?
Having a discussion.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, if you care to make a motion to vote about something,
well,
at some point you are definitely entitled to do that.
Okay, I just wanted to see how official this was. Yeah, but
I've been a tenant. I've never been a landlord. From a former tenant's point of view, I could say I would really love that. I don't know how practical that is from a landlord's point of view.
I give mine back within probably a week to 10 days, but that's me. But I think that usually a billing cycle and in business and bill paying and all, it's usually 30 days, and I think that's pretty much of a standard practice in a lot of places as well. So as far as my impression of it always has been, it's been 30 days, and I think that's pretty much in keeping with, you know, you get a bill, you pay it within 30 days, so.
That is what state law is. I mean, I wouldn't mind that being shortened, because it's technically, security deposits are not, they're not supposed to be mixed with the landlord's personal money.
Right.
They're not supposed to be spent unless,
right,
of course, there's some like
supposed
crazy destruction,
right,
that happens. But that's not supposed to be touched until afterwards. So there shouldn't be an issue of it being returned sooner.
No.
If the landlord is properly keeping the security deposits as they should. Mm-hmm. I personally have no problem with that whatsoever.
Neither do I. I actually think it's kind of a good idea. And I do believe that there is enough support on the board for such a limiting of because from a lot of the problems that I'm hearing from Celeste and from other places, the majority of them seem to be stemming from security deposits either not being returned or being returned at a very slow rate. Is that really the root cause for a lot of the stuff, Celeste?
It's one of two, and the other one is lease breaks, but you're right.
Okay.
So, okay. When it comes to the end of a lease and a security deposit is due, the landlord has to be able to get in and do a property inspection, right, to make sure that the condition is fine. And it's reasonable. If the lease is due, you know, if it's the end of the lease, if it's come to its termination, then the landlord should be planning in advance of that to get that property inspected quickly, right? So I guess the other section is about returning security deposits at lease break, which might be, you know, we have landlords who aren't always in town and may have difficulty arranging for a property inspection. I don't know if that's a situation.
Well, I think usually what happens was, I don't know what you mean as far as making plans to get the property inspected. What you have to do is wait till the people are out.
Yeah.
And they have, you know, when they're leaving, they need to have it as clean as it was when they moved in. And then the day that they're leaving, traditionally you go down and collect their keys, their, you know, whatever, and you look at the apartment and you see that it's clean. And if there's an issue, you say, well, you know what, you could do that a little bit better. And then when you accept their keys back and you say, okay, you're good to go, and then you start processing your return, you know, your security return.
And that's how it should work. I know from experience a lot of times that's not how it does work.
Well, see, I do students, and so therefore a minor leaving one day and 3 days later, the next year is coming
right.
in. So I can't, I think what you're probably saying is for a house that you're not going to have a tenant immediately right afterwards, you have a month or so, or weeks anyway, to go in there and say, yeah, okay, it's good or bad. I don't have that luxury. I have today, I'm looking at it. Tomorrow, I'm tweaking it up, and the next day, somebody else is coming
in. I think you're right. I think that is the majority, certainly not all of, but the majority of the tenant situations in New Paltz are students.
I think so.
I mean, I've been certainly a non-student tenant here as well as a student tenant, but I can see how that rhythm would necessitate a face-to-face interaction. Mm. I don't think that's the case for a lot of people who aren't students.
How would it be handled otherwise then? They leave and drop the keys at a real estate office and
or,
then at some point somebody goes
or at the landlord's
it?
Business and then the landlord goes and looks after and
So I've been thinking about this, and one idea that I really like is putting a timeline towards these kinds of events. So my day job is I'm a banker. And you know, funds availability is a huge issue, right? And it's regulated, and you know, it has to be available this day. If not, because of, you know, extenuating circumstances, people need to be notified. You know, let's say it's like a really big check and they need to hold it to verify it. That has to be sent a letter to that customer to let them know. So I would love to put like landlords on a schedule to say, you know, security deposits need to be returned this long afterwards. But, you know, there are extenuating circumstances. So maybe giving that outlet to say, you know, let's say something extenuating happens that they need extra time, at least to respond by via letter to say, your security deposit's en route to being, you know, returned. I just need to look into these things, but because of this circumstance, it's going to take a little bit longer.
Yeah.
And at least then it gives a check-in, at least. So, you know, the tenant's not sitting there being like, well, what's going on? I'm not getting any letters or calls. At least it's a, okay, I know they're hearing me.
Right, and that can still be gamed, but at least it's trying to have a
mechanism?
An ethical mechanism and a professional mechanism to keep contact between the two parties. Yeah.
Or like FOIL requests, I know that's a thing. Like if, you know, you have a certain amount of days to fulfill it, but let's say, you know, there's a reason why it's going to take a little longer, you know, municipalities have to respond.
Right.
At least they are, you know, obligated to say, we've gotten your request. It's going to take an extra week, though, because of, you know, facilities things or, you know, just logistics. Or we don't have that much paper, you know.
Are we ready?
I can envision a situation where a landlord needs to get something fixed and they need to have a third party come in and fix it. They don't know how much it's going to cost until they get an estimate and they come in.
I can see that.
But I'm wondering if maybe we we can put in a mechanism that says, you know, you have 30 days to put to refund the security deposit, or 2 weeks after a new tenant moves in. Because if someone else is moving in, then at that point everything is good. Celeste, you don't.
I'm not talking. You can keep talking.
I don't know. You threw your hands up and started shaking your head. No, I'm just trying to get feedback.
I kind of want to hear what you have to say, though.
Okay, you know what I'm saying, right? Because if another tenant comes in, landlord has 2 weeks to issue the security deposit being returned, because at that point there are no major issues that someone else is in there. It's already taken care of. Does that seem reasonable?
Yes, and it's sort of.
I'm going to argue that point. No. I've moved in my first apartment in New Paltz. The school year had already started, and I took what I could get as fast as I could get it, and the tenant had moved out literally the day before, and I made a deal with the landlord. You don't even need to repaint the thing. I need to get in there. So in this village, especially the village, but the town too, there's a lot of students who are taking what they can get when they can, and yeah, caveat emptor, but at the same time, a student moving in is not a guarantee that everything's set.
That's a good point. I actually slept on a floor for 2 weeks waiting for someone else to move out.
Right. I mean, and I've moved into, like, you know, abysmal conditions, and it's just like, this isn't up to code, this isn't legal, this is a health hazard, I shouldn't, oh my God, a human shouldn't be breathing this. And it was like, there was a student living there a few days ago for a year.
Yeah.
I think you'd make a timeline, and I know that that goes hand in hand with 30 days, if we were to keep that rather than move it back to the 2 weeks. That if you do not return, let's say the law is 30 days, if you do not return the security within 30 days, you can be liable for treble damages if you did not notify them. They have to either get their money back, or they have to get a letter mailed to their new address stating, I'm keeping your security because, or I will send, as your problem with the check, you know, I'm sending your check, but it will take a week or 10 days to whatever. But you have to notify them in writing within 30 at the 30-day mark if there's some situation that they're just not getting their check back.
Anna, that would be rewriting the wheel. People, other states, I mean, so state legislatures with much bigger budgets than us have looked at this, and they've made laws, and those are the laws I'm trying to get us to accept. The things Dennis is talking about the 2 weeks before the tenant moves in, or the letter you're talking about, it's not like we're the first people that have ever thought of this.
No, but that's a law that we're operating under.
We should take the laws that people that are much smarter than we have come up with when against this and adopt it. And I don't know how it got to a month. That's already the default.
Well, we explained how it got to a month.
Well, you're asking me what the proposal is that I researched in other places. I'm telling you the proposal is 2 weeks. It works in Ithaca. I don't know why, if it works in Ithaca, it can't work here. It's 3 hours away.
I have to say that, I mean, I think there's probably a lot of reasons why. It's a great idea to emulate Ithaca, for instance. I don't know enough about it to be like, is it enough, for instance, the student to, you know, other tenant ratio could be incredibly different. Mm-hmm.
There are
a difference.
There are a lot
the population difference is, you know, a big factor.
Can I suggest, I really like the idea of 2 weeks if there are no repairs to be made. If there's nothing that needs to be done, 2 weeks. 30 days if anything is seen that needs to be repaired. But then if there's repairs, that's taking it out of the security deposit, right? So it's whatever would remain out of the repairs, if anything would remain out of the repairs. So 30 days, if there's any, if there's anything that needs to be repaired. And if either of those deadlines can't be met, there needs to be a letter sent to the former tenant at that time.
Right, but the 30-day mark making repairs, that has to be outlined and detailed to the tenant as well.
Right.
You know, you can't just not ever, you can't send them back $50 and hope they're going to take it. You have to send them back the $50 and say,
here's,
you had $500,
you
I am taking
yeah.
out this,
yes.
that, and the other thing.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, they already have that. You're supposed to provide receipts for any deductions without even the tenant asking. You're supposed to say, you're getting $50, and here's where the rest of the money went. to this painter, to this plumber, to this person, you know, receipts.
And, yeah, it needs to happen. It's just not always happening.
Very rare.
I like your thing about 2 weeks if there's no repairs necessary. That's fine. That sounds good.
Hi, everybody. Hi. I'm representing tenants. Just kind of hearing everything, I really like the 2 weeks idea. Clearly, I'm, you know, one of the only people that's kind of leaning towards that. I also really like the timeline idea. So in my mind, I've kind of worked the two of them. So right now in New York State law, if you get a secured deposit, you're supposed to put it in a bank account. Mm-hmm. So you have access to that. It's not like you have to go collect funds from other tenants to pay the tenants that are leaving. You should have pretty easy access to that. So I think it's completely reasonable that we you know, think about maybe a 1 week stipulation to look at the apartment, you know, review it, if repairs need to be done, you know, do the repairs, send a letter. And then after that point, you know, 2 weeks, you have like 2 weeks to send the deposit back. They can do more than enough time to go to the bank, everything like that. So rather than 30 days or 2 weeks, we're looking at 3 weeks as, you know, more of a turnaround, as kind of a compromise between the two. And I, you know, I like the idea where, you know, they have a week to look at everything, 2 weeks to send it. If there are repairs, like, you know, you could send a certified letter or something like that. So I really did like that idea as well. Because a lot of times, you know, I've had it where I've moved out of a place and, you know, I've contacted the landlord and just never gotten anything back ever. And like, you know, it's at least reassuring to get something back, being like, hey, you know, the reason you haven't gotten it back yet is because, you know, I haven't reached the toilet or this.
I like that with the a week's limit to get into the place and look at it. You can't lollygag around, you know, two months later go check. It's your job. If you're a landlord, that's part of your job. You need to be checking the place now.
3 weeks, you know, there's going to be dust on stuff. Like somebody could break it and destroy the place, and now that kind of lies.
Right, no, I think that's a great idea.
So there should definitely be a time limit on, you know, you have X amount of time to actually get in there and perform your, you know.
This is assuming it's the end of the scheduled lease.
Yes.
So we're not talking about anything like an unplanned end of the lease or an early.
I was just talking about the first thing Celeste brought up, which is the 2 weeks. That my take is kind of this 1 week to get in, 2 weeks, you know, after that to get them the money.
Yep.
I continue to disagree. You know, Burlington has had this law for 31 years and they're fine. The landlords there are fine. Landlords here can return it in 2 weeks. They don't want to. And you said you return it in 10 days. If there is a repair, like a major repair, like let's say the ceiling fell through, well then they could withhold it, and then if they're brought to court by the tenant, they can go in front of the judge and say, this is why I didn't return it, and the judge isn't going to say, well, we're going to punish you for doing that. No. What you're doing is saying that this law that already works in so many places miraculously couldn't work here, and I object to that.
I don't think that that's what we're saying at all. And for one, just because a law works in one place doesn't mean it's going to work in another. Two, just because a New York State legislature adopted something doesn't mean it's good. There's plenty of bad things that have been passed by state legislators. Now I'm not saying that this is one of them. I'm just saying that just because other places have done it doesn't necessarily mean it was a good idea. However, I mean, I do like looking at the precedent and how things have worked out in other places. States is a little bit different than a local municipality. But we need to look into, because for a lot of things you can put stricter protections on the municipal level than the New York State level, but with certain things you can't. So with the 30 days, I am in favor of two weeks to return the security deposit. I'm definitely in favor of that. I do like the idea that they have to do it within 1 week. Celeste, I said this in the very
beginning. I'm not talking.
It doesn't matter. You're on camera, and so is your attitude. So I would just really like a little bit more respect coming from you. We're here to discuss. Well, then, you know, I don't know what to say to that, because we're trying to have a respectful discussion.
Can we stick to the issues?
Can you stop interrupting, please?
You're talking about me.
I don't care. It doesn't matter. That doesn't matter. Like, so anyway, back to the topic at hand. Because we can do this without you. We would like to work with you, but we don't need to.
But I can't talk. I can't answer that.
Well, I didn't ask a question. So, and now I'm not sure where I left off. Like I said, I stated a while ago, in fact, when we exactly began this discussion, you can watch it on camera, I said I was in favor, that I had no issue at all with 2 weeks' return. So
that, I don't know, reaction was uncalled for. But anyway, so, and now, yeah, I don't exactly remember what my point was, but the, yeah, I'm, oh yeah, just about other things that other places have done. I mean, that's not like, that's not enough of a reason to say, well, you should pass this because this place did and it worked out okay. Like, that is definitely part of information to support passing legislation, definitely, but it's not the sole reason. So we need more information, we need more details, and we need more reasons for a lot of these things, and just listing off a bunch of states that have passed similar laws isn't really good enough. And we can take your word for it that they worked out just fine in some of these other places, and some of them may have. I personally don't see how, you know, returning the security deposit within 2 weeks, if there was no legitimate reasons for deducting from the security deposit, I don't really see how that would bankrupt landlords anywhere. And again, that's why I'm in support of it. But there's some things in here that you use those same exact defenses for, which I don't think is a valid enough argument to convince anyone to pass it. Like I said, we're trying to discuss this and thoroughly discuss this and make something really good out of this, because there are a lot of good components to it. So I feel like if we all can just breathe and really want to work together, and otherwise, like I said, we can do this without you. We don't want to do it without you. We'd rather do it with you. This is your child. But the board can take any of this and leave some of it to you and make their own legislation with or without you. That is absolutely something that the state legislature can do. So, or the, yeah, state legislature, the village board can do. But like I said, we invited you here not to argue, but to actually discuss this. So yeah, I'm going off topic now.
Can I just make the point that this is a public meeting? I don't have to be invited here. That's my whole point.
You can come to the meeting, but you have to be invited to the table. You don't automatically get to come to the meeting and speak over everybody. You know, and much like Amanda's saying here, I mean, it sounds like there is a lot of support for a two-week limit on security deposits here, Celeste, so I'm not sure why you're fighting us instead of trying to find what everybody can agree on. And then if there's anything that we don't agree on that you don't agree with, let us know why. But it doesn't have to be confrontational. It can be collaborative.
Exactly. Yeah. Go ahead.
So, like, the way that I would like to see this happen is I think that we should pick, you know, the three best topics from this and just start working on those, because like there are a lot of topics being touched on, Celeste, in your proposed law, and it just, you know, when talking about so many issues, that's when people get divided and muddled, and you know, I like these two things but not these three things. So maybe we should just section off like three things that we can solidly make a change on that we can all come together and agree on, and then start with those three, and then when we knock those three down, pick a few more, you know.
You good? All right.
I'm fine.
I'd really like it if we could set aside any of the rhetoric of it worked there, why won't you do it here? I'd like to hear what they're doing here as a model for, here's some suggestions. But this is New Paltz, and New Paltz is going to find New Paltz's solution. And that means a solution that works for the people who are representing the different groups. So just, I think it's unreasonable to expect that just hands down we're going to say, oh, it worked someplace else, great. All right, so I like the 2 weeks. I understand the reason for suggesting the 3 weeks. I think we've discussed it to a point where we came to a certain amount of agreement, yeah?
I like 3 weeks, but actually the 2 weeks kind of takes care of that as well, because if you have to send the money back within 2 weeks, then you've obviously gotten in there, so it doesn't matter whether you want the first day or the 13th day.
That's what I was thinking.
So it's the 2 weeks that the money's either in the mail or there's a letter in the mail explaining, I'm sorry, I have to replace the window or blah.
Yeah, I just want to say I'm in complete support of the 2 weeks. I was just proposing that as maybe, you know.
No, I thought it was good.
Yeah, compromise.
So, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, it's okay. I just remember the thing I was trying to remember before was that we would check to make sure that it's legal to do that. Oh, no, because if it's done it, then it's going to be okay, so then we can totally do it. Never mind.
Can I answer my question?
The other question I have, I'm sorry.
Once we come up with a complete list of what we do support as a board, we'll send it to the village attorney as well. So anything, he'll flesh out any issues.
Cool.
Excellent.
Is there any issue with, since so many landlords in the, and I don't think this is going to be an issue, but I just want to throw it out there. Since so many landlords in New Paltz have so many tenants, like tenants, does accessing those funds to return to the tenants all at once at the end of a semester, does that create a problem?
I don't think so, because as everyone said, this is a dedicated fund.
Right.
They're really not allowed to touch it.
Right. Yeah, no, I figured, I just didn't
know. It's like withholding sales tax, this and that, you're not allowed to touch it. It's got to be there once it's due.
Yeah, let's go behind the 2 weeks then.
Do you want to do like a formal vote, or?
I move that we vote in favor of security deposits being returned within 2 weeks if there's no need for repairs.
Wait.
Is that what we said? Or?
Yeah. And a letter if there is a need for
that's
repair.
That's not what I said at all.
No, that's what we said.
That's what we said. That's the
point. Well, I just want to clarify to everyone on this board that what's going to happen, and I'm speaking from experience, is that landlords are going to say, well, they need to do repairs, so they're not going to return it, and the repairs are going to be made up. Well, I'm going to keep the $2,000 deposit because I kind of need to repair the microwave. That's my concern.
Well, then it will go to court, and then it will be decided in court.
But here's the trick with going to court is that if the tenants live planted away, then how are they going to take and we have a lot of international tenants here. How are they going to take a landlord to small claims court?
Well, if you have the 2 weeks, so they're going to be back to wherever they came from, too. So you're not solving that.
Also, I just want to point out that, there are landlords out there that do take predatory motions of, picking young people who don't know their rights. They don't know how to, launch a small claims court suit. So, this isn't every landlord, but there are some landlords that definitely pry upon that. And those tenants, transitory students, people who don't feel like they have enough money to win. I just don't want to see those people get left out.
And that's partly also part of what our job is going to be, is making sure we get that information out to everybody in the community and educate them on what their rights are. And then knowing what their resources are, like if they're students, they can get free legal advice from Nancy Crossover. And if they're seniors, they can get free legal advice from Office of the Aging. If they're anybody in between, they're screwed. There's resources.
I'll let you know.
For us too. I fall on there too. There's resources for us too. But that is part of our job. Is that education, letting people know what their rights are and letting them know what resources are available.
While we're on the topic of education, that's something that pretty much got me to want to be on this board. I know it's kind of out of place since we're discussing the 2 weeks thing. But I don't know if it's possible for us, as a committee or council to do this, but could we hold like an information booth at SUNY New Paltz so students have the kind of rights handbooks, because so many students just don't know their rights and they don't know where it's.
It would, I'm pretty sure, be a good thing to collaborate with Nyberg with that, because they do that a lot. I've seen them a bunch of times at the farmers market on Thursdays on campus. And they do hold information sessions, and they give you like the tenants' rights handbook and everything. Actually, it seems to me like it actually like wasn't even enough to like get people there. It was only like kind of a few students who were not having a landlord dispute, but were still interested in going. Do you know what I mean? So it was like two people who were there being thank goodness I happened upon this, and then two people who were just like this is just good to know.
Well,
generally.
The other thing I was thinking, my original thought kind of in regards to outreach is somehow make it so when, if you're a landlord, when somebody is signing your lease, either on the lease itself or you physically hand them a copy of the tenant's right handbook, or on the lease itself, it, directs you to the webpage with the tenant's right handbook. Because, that way everybody signs a lease, everybody will see it, whether or not you are on it at SUNY New Paltz.
But we can't mandate what lease different landlords offer. can we?
Regardless of these, I mean, a tenant's a tenant. They should know their rights.
Sure, absolutely. I don't think that you can mandate that the landlord's the one who tells them that.
One of the things that I said to Jacob when he called me, because I said, you know, he said, what do you do with the meetings? And I said, how we had kind of just gotten our ducks in a row the last meeting, because we had just started. And I said, you know, we're not a judicial body, so I don't know that we're going to be making laws and just deciding law cases. I said, I think one of the most important things that we would do would be educational, and that's exactly what we had talked about at the first meeting back before Christmas and last month. And also, you know, obviously I'm a landlord and you're tenants, but both sides need to be educated, as Dennis brought up last month. You know, landlords need information too. Tenants need information as to what their rights and responsibilities are, and landlords need to know what their rights and responsibilities. They both have rights, they both have responsibilities. Maybe you don't want to be a landlord. Maybe you're looking at buying a house and, you know, you want to get some information as to how things go. So it's the educational thing that I think this committee would be so important to provide.
I agree.
Yes, go ahead.
Without interruption, please. Well, this was an entire meeting, and the only thing we covered was probably the biggest softball of them all, the two-week provision, which we already had three people on the board to say they vote for. How long do you think it'll take, if you meet once a month, to go through all of this? It would take an eternity. And I'm not going to come to another meeting, but there are things like Ithaca already passed this law. The landlords will say that something needs to be fixed. Things that attorneys that work in this area of law would know, that you fine people would never even think of, just because it's not possible. So I believe that this law should be constructed by professionals who took the time or have the time to research this. And it was constructed by professionals, and that's the law I came up with. If you want to redo the law, it will take you forever, and you'll be missing a lot.
So, if you had actually come months ago when you were first invited, perhaps we would have gotten a little bit farther. Because I did, when you first talked to me about this, and I asked you repeatedly to send me this, which you never sent me, maybe we would have gotten a lot farther in this conversation, because that was something I told you to do when you first started telling me about this a very long time ago. And second,
I'm sorry, this is really distracting. Would you mind putting your pen down and just like make eye contact with whoever's looking?
I can hold my pen.
Well, could you also stop playing?
It's very distracting.
I don't know what to tell you.
It's also not an entire meeting. We're less than an hour in. Only an hour, exactly an hour in. So it's not an entire meeting, and we can still keep going. And also, you have been one of the big wasters of time in this meeting, being argumentative instead of constructive. So the other thing is, it's not lawyers' jobs to make the laws. It's the job of legislative bodies, and that is something that is what we have elected you guys have elected your village board to do and our town boards to do. And they're not lawyers either. And they're not necessarily technically professionals. I guess they're being paid elected officials, so I guess that makes them professional elected officials. And they're the ones who are actually responsible for making laws. Now, as good elected officials, we hope they seek the advice of attorneys and the public, which they are doing. And then that's their job, to help them make the laws. So you saying, hey, we're a bunch of professional lawyers, you should just do what we tell you, doesn't really fly with us.
Well,
with me, I should say.
The legislative body seeks the input of their constituents too.
Yes.
And there is absolute, from what I read of the proposed law, there isn't any way that I could support it just carte blanche. The lease requirement, that you must offer somebody a lease for a year, I do, but they can get out of it with a 30-day notice, then what is the point of a year lease? So there are things
amended.
Like that
that's
in
not
it.
The law.
Pardon me?
That was amended. That's an old version of the law.
All right, well, that's what I read. So that was something that I couldn't, that was just absolutely, as I said, tenants and landlords have rights and responsibilities, both of them. And that lease idea was completely abusive to a landlord.
Yeah, I have to say there were I haven't seen the revised version. I think I saw part of the original version, and I thought there were some things that were very helpful for tenants and landlords both, but I also thought that there were some things that were very strongly and it seemed to me unreasonably biased toward tenants. So I think that there's middle ground to find there, but it is going to take some working and talking and figuring out what works for everybody, and that takes time.
And I have to say also just I feel I am a tenant. I've only been a tenant. I'm a student tenant. I feel like I've been taken advantage of because I happen to go to school at SUNY New Paltz. I can't tell if you're listening, and I feel like you've screamed a lot, and I'm kind of like, why, I'm on your side, like, wait, I'm on the tenant's side, like, why, you know, it's
stop making
very
this
aggressive.
Person. No, okay, you know what,
well,
this,
I'm just
this, this
the
is
less
the courtroom theater that she's
yelling.
Doing, just let her do it, because she's
I thought
out.
Would have just, would
so
make things go faster, never mind.
Just make your point to us. Yeah.
So,
just Kenny, go ahead, I just thought it would just go faster, never mind, that was just a suggestion, fine.
Thank you, Anna. So I think a great thing to talk about maybe is the credit checks.
Yes.
Let's just move on to the next topic. I, as well as you said, Amanda, really
miss
like
it.
That idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not in the current version.
Yeah. Just because, you know, credit checks are derogatory, you know?
What is the rule that was the proposed rule
to
credit checks?
Ban credit checks when it comes to extending lease opportunities. So using it as a deciding factor,
right?
Which we know that credit can, you know, be heavily racist, classist, and it would cut out a lot of people based on an arbitrary thing. You know, we've all worked with credit, and it's very arbitrary. It's not, you know,
yeah.
something that you can easily explain. Like if you do this, this, and this, you'll have a good score. This, that, or that.
It also reinforces credit economy
mm-hmm.
because you can't get a good credit rating unless you have a rotating balance on your
yeah.
credit cards. And that way lies peril, especially for students. So, yeah, that's, I think getting rid, to me it sounds like a good idea. How does it sound?
Fine to me, because I'll tell you why. I have never done a credit check on a tenant. I think that you can replace, and besides, a bad credit score or a credit check is it can be very, you know, misrepresentative of their intent to do something, you know, this year.
Right.
And the thing is that you can get around that with references. You ask them for several references, be it their last landlord, something, you know, an employer. Whatever. And
I
then you can find out.
Look. I mean, I would love to get rid of that.
Yeah, I don't
yeah.
think it's necessary.
Not to mention, anytime anybody checks your credit, whether it's a
it
potential
your
employer,
it's
or
a dig on
it,
credit.
It detracts from your credit score, so it's just like, yeah.
I don't know that that's 100%
stuff.
True, but I just don't think so. But I just think that it's not necessary.
Yeah, every time your credit is checked,
yeah,
it's okay. a ding
yeah.
against your
when
credit.
When it's a hard
a
pull,
bit.
When they
yeah.
use your, when it's a hard pull, it dings your credit. It's not a huge ding, but it is. But people,
if there's a lot of them all at once, it
yeah,
adds up. All
people forget though, your credit can be ruined for very, you know,
mm-hmm.
innocent things. Like
mm-hmm.
I've seen, you know, people at the bank where a divorce was what caused their credit to tank. You know, because they had shared assets and had to, you know, get rid of it. And why would that? You know, hold someone back. Let's say they're trying to get an apartment after being divorced. Like, that's not
mm-hmm.
productive.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. May I ask? Is there a reason why it wasn't in the in it was amended?
I don't want to answer that.
Okay.
Clerk Wojcik.
I don't really know how to address.
Yeah. Was there a finished vote on the 2 week thing? Because I'm now remembering that we kind of
yeah.
that kind of dissolved back into discussion.
I have Robin moved.
Okay.
Second.
Yay, we have a second.
Can I get
okay, Robin moves to approve that landlords return security deposits within 2 weeks if no repairs are necessary, and if repairs are necessary, must
communicate such to the tenant.
Communicate via certified mail.
I think that's pretty court standard in tenant issues, certified mail to communicate, because
okay.
then you can prove it. You can say
Well, it's on the onus of the landlord to prove it, so if they don't have a certified
It's right. in their best interest.
Yeah, yeah exactly. And if repairs further need to be done, the remainder of the deposit needs to be returned within 30 days. Is that what else we said? Is that mm-hmm. the remainder of that?
Okay. I second that.
All right.
That was seconded. So.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'm gonna be honest. I was taking notes. Can you please just? I don't even know what was just you going to aye.
This is the 2 week thing.
Oh. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. So, are we unanimous? Is there anybody opposed?
No. Yes, I was just writing that.
Okay.
Is there another big issue in your?
Okay. Well, now we're on to
the credit check.
So should we do a form? Or we did yeah. finish discussing that?
I think we're finished discussing that.
Yeah, it's fine. Is there another big issue that we would want to cover now?
Let's do that. I move.
It's just good to have it in the middle.
Second.
Great. I move that landlords are not, how do we
prevent banned that from using credit checks to...
Is banned the right word?
To discriminate?
Okay. Include a ban on credit checks in what we are drafting.
Okay.
Yep. They can work out those.
Right,
yeah, they can mark
that. Because it's moving it towards what we're going to consider.
All right. Yeah.
So I second that, and we've done it, and that was all the ayes that happened.
You have to say all in favor.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 All right. So Celeste, do you have another issue that you would want to go over now while we have another 45 minutes, 50
Anyone
minutes?
Anyone that read the law can choose the next issue. I don't have to.
I would like to hear what you think would be like a next on your list of preferences.
As a tenant attorney who does this professionally, I think that the 2 week law as you wrote it isn't going to help, but that's just my professional opinion as someone that does this every week. What do I know?
Well, that's why it's going to lawyers after us.
And that's why we asked you, why do you think it won't work?
How is it different from what the two? How is our 2 weeks different from your 2 weeks?
Because it has an exception for repairs. Every landlord will just say they have repairs.
No, and they'd have to prove it in court.
And if it doesn't work in practice, we revise it.
I just am curious, will you say, like, you know, every landlord would say they have repairs, so if they're, you know, the landlord's sending a certified letter claiming that these repairs are made, how much liability would that put them in if they were pressed by a court for, you know, proof, whether even just like a notarized letter from the repair person saying, I'm currently working on this?
Significant, but then, I mean, the fact that there's still the issue of tenants being empowered and having the ability to take the landlords to court and knowing how to do that, and that comes down to the education piece that Jeff mentioned. I think it also needs to come down to there needs to be a system. There needs to be a system whereby tenants can be empowered to do that. And I think that's not just education, there's got to be more than that. So maybe that's part of what we can end up being, but that's going to be a process, and we're not going to
exactly
be able to solve that tonight.
It seems like, you know, that we've got the resources there. It's just kind
yeah.
of
the whole,
I don't know, convincing people that it is, like, you should probably just educate yourself on this, you know, as soon as you become a tenant.
But you also have to know where to look to get educated on this too.
Well,
exactly.
But also, you know, everyone.
Yeah.
I mean, just the way I said it just now, like, that doesn't
yeah.
even. That's not.
Yeah, that's
really that practical. I mean, I feel like
I
that it's
that
people are like, I have school and I have work and I have family, and, you know.
As a question, right. as a question of for student tenants, as a suggestion of a model, I know that Albany has a very active student, you know, off-campus resident program,
mm-hmm.
where they're regularly, and I've seen this at a couple of other colleges too. They're regularly sending around information, informing students about how to do this, how to do that. And some of what it is how to clean your kitchen floor so that your landlord's not going to get upset.
Oh, I should adopt
that. You know, how to do, how to take, people, this is their first time away from home, and they don't know how to take care of a property in a way where they'll be able to get their deposit back.
I know of a landlord who consistently has someone, you know, come and hired to come and clean.
But wouldn't it
be tenants? Adult tenants,
right? But wouldn't it be great if we could help them figure out how to do it? I mean, it's baby stuff that they should have learned at home, but
it's not always.
Yeah.
And see, there you go with your rights and responsibilities. Yeah, and that is a great educational thing. Jacob and I talked about that too. He said, what are some of your problems? I said, well, you know what it is? I said, a lot of these kids, it's the first time they've come away from home, and they're used to their mother doing this and their father doing that, and they move in and they're like, and they just don't know it. And so they're, you know, if something's going on, like, and I said too, in the city, a lot of those huge apartment buildings, there's no way to turn the heat down unless you open the window. You don't turn the boiler down in a 30-story building. I said, they come up here, they're in a house, they open up windows, and there goes your heat. And I say, you cannot open the window if you want to turn the thermostat down.
So there's education. A big educational curve to moving into a new place. I don't care what age you are or whatever. If you're going from one type of living situation to another, it's going to be a learning curve. Right. So since we know there's a lot of people who are living in a new place for the first time, that's something maybe we could help facilitate.
Mm-hmm. And had you mentioned SUNY Albany, or was it
just Albany? And I saw another college that had like this huge instruction book of how to be a good tenant.
Yeah. Right, and again, we can't just grab these things and take them, you know, and take them, but it's like we can still take the, you know, the idea and make it work.
As a model.
Yeah,
you know, so
absolutely.
I understand Celeste's job and her dealings with landlords that may be doing things that are not appropriate, but I don't think that there is, and I certainly hope there isn't, and I don't want us to feel that there is this animosity between landlords and tenants. I mean, I have only students, and I mean, I get Christmas cards. I get people sending their younger brother, you know, Mrs. Dietz, do you have a room? I live there. I have people coming back 5 years later. I'm going back to school. Can I get a room? You know, and so I think that you can have very, very good relationships with
Absolutely.
Your tenants. And that booklet of helping a person succeed as a tenant and whatever, I think that's a great idea. And I just hope that people don't think that there's just this war between landlords and tenants, because there shouldn't be.
There shouldn't be. There are some landlords in this community who are not
fair
players.
Yeah.
And you know, certainly not all of them, but they are there.
And some of them have kind of mastered it to an art.
Exactly.
They're good.
Some of them are chair of this board.
So, with education, because just touching back on the security deposits a little bit, because whether it's 30 days or 2 weeks, there's still going to be landlords who are going to try to give it back at all.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Whatever the timeline, they're going to try to withhold it anyway, because that's what they do. And again, they've got it perfected to an art. Yeah, some of them. Again, and small claims court, like, although it is basically what your option is when, as far as, you know, going to court, unless you have to go to county court, even if you get awarded that, the landlord can still just not pay it, and then you have to, like, go through all this other rigmarole. You have to, like, try to either, like, take their federal income tax return, or, like, put, garnish their wages, or, like, there's all these things that you then have to do as the person who's owed the money.
And if you are unrepresented.
And if you don't know certain things about them, you might even have to hire a private detective. Like, there's all kinds of crazy things that can come about when you're trying to even, and sometimes, like, the judgment comes down and people just pay what they're told to pay, but sometimes that's still not the case in small claims court. So we still need to find all these resources that can help people beyond what we can do, educate them on their rights, and send them to these resources that can help them when we
absolutely.
I think it's basically going to come down to the fact that judgment granted in a court is not worth the paper it's written on in many, many, many cases, either be it landlord against tenant or tenant against landlord.
So,
and it's very frustrating on both
meaning,
sides.
Wait, what did you
say? In other words, landlords are going to ignore a lot of some landlords.
Or anything.
Some tenants may ignore.
Any judgments. I'm in business, and I have had people that haven't paid their bill for tree services, and 20 years ago I got a judgment. I haven't ever seen a dime. You know, and it's a constant, renew it. Spend more money to file it. Da 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 da. Eventually, you just give up. So that's going to be a problem that you're going to have in any court dealing.
So the first step that we can take is continue doing what we're doing and try and refine the lease issues, right? So you were concerned that we had only touched on the most softball of them. And now we've touched on another one. What's another one that you are concerned is a significant one?
Caps on security deposits.
That's one that I was concerned about.
Can I explain why it's in the law?
Absolutely. Okay.
As Amanda pointed out, there's two choices for tenants. There's small claims court and there's county court. In these larger houses, let's say the security deposit can be $1,000 per person, but there's six people. Now let's say one of the damages is the garage door was dented. So that's a common question of fact. If those six people file individually, the landlord can have it dismissed for necessary parties. Me and Dennis spoke at length about this. So what people with security deposits over $3,000 combined have been doing is they've been forfeiting it. They've been saying, I want all my money, but I can't go. They need an attorney to go to county court, and they can't afford an attorney. It would eat up the entire security deposit, and it would take a very long time. I won't even do it for them, and I do a lot, because we're talking about pretrial motions. We're talking about, you know, various hearings. So my interest is in keeping all of the claims in small claims court. Now, one of what Ms. Dietz said earlier was something called treble damages. That's something that a lot of other places have enacted as a penalty for withholding security deposits. So we have to think the max, if we're gonna do treble damages, has to be $1,000 per whatever unit. And we've got people with eight people living in it, you know. So that's pretty much why I think there should be a cap. If there's no cap, you're going to continue to have people that have no chance of relief for a certain amount of their security deposit.
What was the word that you used in the first place when you said it was dismissed because of why? If they went individually and sued, it was dismissed why?
Well,
you used a term.
This would be putting me in the position of advising a landlord.
No, did she say that?
No, and then she's a council member.
I just wanted to know.
She's a council member now.
So I believe what she said.
I just asked you to repeat the word terminology.
What's the terminology that you used when you were talking about the reason it would be dismissed?
It's called necessary party.
That's what I.
What does that mean?
What does that mean?
It means that if there's a common question of fact, and thank you for making me explain this to landlords, that's truly my goal. If there's a common question of fact amongst the parties, they have to bring the lawsuit together. They have to be co-plaintiffs. We can't have each person, each tenant, bring the suit separately. They could try, but a landlord could ask for it to be dismissed.
So
thank
let
you
me understand.
For making me explain that explicitly.
I'm sure that any landlord, as you have pointed out, would have a lawyer available to explain it to them. So, what you're saying, if I'm understanding correctly, in the case of the dented garage door, if there was any question about who was responsible for the dented garage door, that's what you're saying, that they would all have to come completely at the same time? Or is it because they would have
they have a shared responsibility for it.
Because they have the shared deposit. Is that what you're saying? Or because they have a shared lease?
Right, well, it's a shared space. You know, sometimes they do the leases individually, but that's what you'll see is like, you know, kitchen stove has a burn on it, $200 out of everyone's deposit.
This landlord is not going to be dragged into court 7 different times.
I see what you're saying. Okay. And you, what is the cap for small claims court?
It's $3,000.
$3,000? Okay. Now, I haven't understood before about, I mean, I agree trying to keep small, trying to keep landlord-tenant issues, especially in a situation where it's not like a, you know, the landlords, like the apartment building landlords, when it's private property landlords, I absolutely agree with that, trying to stay in small claims court. I hadn't understood the idea of treble damages making it possibly no longer possible to go into small claims court. So I thought, you know, up until that, I thought, well, okay, I think $1,000 for the max is a little low for what people are renting right now. I mean, it's normally, what, 1 month for security or two?
I mean, I've paid.
Differs.
Yeah, 3.
I would say the average is 1.
Yeah.
At least, like, all my leases have been 1.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of people that do collect a larger amount of money than that.
I don't think I've ever seen 1 from me.
Really?
Yeah, 3 months.
Well, no, but often it's 1 month security, 1 month deposit, and 1 month.
I ask for, and I am very lenient, and so I let them slide a lot, but I ask for security when they sign the lease, and then when they move in, I would like to have first and last, and then I let them, I say, I know it's a lot of money, so they, I said you can make installment payments on it as you go through. I'd just like to have the last month's rent, which is May, paid in, you know, sometime like in the early winter, and I often don't get that either.
So,
but that's not a deposit. That's
no, but there are. But don't forget, I've never been party to this, but I know one of my kids lived in one of the apartment complexes, and they not only have a security, they have a they have a cleaning deposit, with all kinds of different ways that you can work it around so that you're holding more money.
So it's not if we say okay, your security deposit can max at $1,000, then some landlords will say, well, okay, but you have a cleaning deposit of $1,050. You know,
see, those numbers to me are ludicrous. I just don't do that.
So no,
but people do though.
I know they do. I know they do.
With treble damages, now that's something that you put the claim in for, or is that something that's awarded by the judge after you won?
I think it's. I don't know, but I've heard that it's awarded afterwards. They
so
decide the merits of the case.
The filing for small claims.
So it wouldn't. It shouldn't affect it because it's something. It's like a. It's something that the judge does punitively.
Right.
After the case has been decided in the small claims court.
I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't the treble damages part of your proposal to get treble damages to be a benefit of?
You have to ask for the damages. You have to put in your claim what you're asking for. The treble damages does go towards the limit.
Okay.
I'm not guessing.
Okay, so
nobody was asking. You were guessing. I just was asking for clarification.
All right, okay. Knowing that landlords can work around it, it seems like something that we could put in the rules, but it would be kind of a lost hope, because then some landlords would just say, well, then you know, there's no rule about a max on cleaning deposits.
It's going to matter the structure of your lease too, because you know if you're renting out the house as a whole to however many people, or if you're doing leases to each individual person, then they're only responsible for their own deal. So I'm sure that there's a lot of factors that go into it. But
On the February 22nd meeting here, Dennis brought up actually a good point in regards to that. If we put a cap of $200 on, a deposit, what's to say landlords aren't just going to raise the rent to compensate for the difference?
Yeah. I have an answer to that. So I did the research, or it wasn't me, it was someone that works for me, and we've seen that this is evidence. That's why I'm saying this. This is factual evidence that in other places that have done this, the rent hasn't increased.
Can you name those places?
Burlington.
How would that, I can't wrap my head around that. If you only ask for a small deposit and then increase the rent, why would I, so in other words, you're being compensated for more than you really needed each month for the room to
well,
make a bank, to damage
house? What I mean was that,
who's going to do that?
If a landlord faces $600 in damages from a tenant and they only have $200,
right.
How are they going to make that $400 back?
Right.
They're going to increase the rent on the next person coming in the door.
The next person or the person that does only giving them the $200? See, I don't see, to me a tenant wouldn't do that. I'm not living here. I'm going elsewhere.
Except that a lot of the tenants who live here take what they can get.
Absolutely.
I've heard stories of a tenant who was living in a stairwell, or like it was in an apartment building and the tenant rented out the stairwell.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you're talking about my old place.
Oh,
there you go. Your old street?
Probably. I mean, and that's a lot of tenants in this community will live in really rough conditions.
I think a month, and like for me, I do with a month, but I would think that, so the $200, that doesn't address any concern that you would have, and that's why you need security. You're protecting yourself against an unpaid month of rent at the end of the lease, let's say, or some minor damages. Hopefully there would be minor if you're going to collect for them. So maybe and $200 wouldn't address any of that. So if you had a month and a half, even if you wanted to cap it at not a dollar amount, because I don't know what you're renting your property for or whatever, but so you don't want to do a dollar amount. What about a ratio of how much a month's rent is, and make it a month and a half? The month's rent is going to cover, okay, I thought I paid my rent, so I'm not paying you again, but you didn't, so I'm keeping that month. And then I put a hole in the wall when I was mad, so here's a half a month to fix that. I think the ratio.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Celeste, but the purpose of the cap is to keep people out of county court.
Exactly.
It's to enable tenants to stay.
Right.
So that doesn't address the core issue that this is trying to solve.
Right. If you do a ratio, then chances are it could go above 3,000 very easily.
It likely would.
And that would take it out of small claims, as I'm following this. Can you?
So the way that I see it, and I don't know if I agree capping it at 200, I would love to see a world in which we could put some like regulations on it, but how I see it is that it more puts it in the landlord's court that if, you know, there are damages that exceed the security deposit, they need to recoup that money.
Yeah.
So it's more, the ball is in the landlord's court, which for many of the landlords in New Paltz, it is their full-time job,
yeah.
You know, many of them. So it kind of almost makes more sense that if they, you know, had a legitimate legal claim, that it would be, you know, on them more to bring it up than, you know, leaving it in the student's court to be like, well, if you think you've been cheated, well, you have small claims court to go by.
So
that's just, I don't know if I could agree with the 200, but that's the reasoning I see, because a full-time landlord has, you know, the money, the knowledge, hopefully, and, you know, the connections to be able to.
And the lawyer on retainer.
Most likely, you know, if we're talking about, you know, somebody who has 16 properties in the village,
yeah.
And rents all of them, they're more equipped to go to small claims court, get a judgment, than I think a 18-year-old SUNY student who lives in California when they're not in school.
Well, they're also going to be mobile. They're not going to be across the country. You know,
yeah.
So I don't like that.
I don't agree with the 200. I think that's way more.
But I think that's the idea behind
it. I see where
it.
You're going with that.
I would like to see it where it's maybe more shifted towards the person, you know, running the business. Because a lot of, like, claims, you know, for, like, it just kind of makes more sense in my mind.
But you seem to be leaving it up to the fact that the landlord is not going to be holding an amount of money that would compensate him, so he's going to have to go to court for it. And I know, as I mentioned to you last month, that if the person leaves town, goes back to Long Island, you have to sue them in Long Island.
No.
I'm sorry. I've been to Long Island.
It has to be where the transaction took place.
Maybe they changed that.
Whoever you're making a claim against, it has to be where they work or live.
Okay, but then they've left New Paltz. They're no longer living in New Paltz because they've left. I had an occasion.
Oh, you mean if you're just a tenant, you mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
I had an occasion where the tenant, she left, and I, you know, I didn't get the rent, and I called her. I said, "Where's the rent?" "Oh, I moved out in January. She had a lease until August." And I said, "Well, you can't do that." So I took her to court. I had to go down to Long Island, and the guy laughed me out of court as a rube, coming to the big city. And I had thought all along that was horribly unfair. To me, it's not a crime to not pay your rent, but the crime occurred in New Paltz, and so therefore she should have had to come back to New Paltz and answer those charges, but I had to go to Long Island.
Heard landlords putting provisions in their leases, though, that say if, you know, any court matters need to be handled, they will be handled in Ulster County. I've had landlords that put those stipulations, and if you both sign that lease, mm-hmm. Courts will uphold it, that you're saying, I agree to handle the business in Ulster County. While I imagine your situation was more than frustrating, it's kind of, you know, both sides would have to experience that. You know, whether it's a student who would have to maybe try to plan a trip back from California to come see their day in court. So, you know, either way, like, somebody is getting that nasty situation. But I think, like, you know, putting a provision there that, like, we both agree, because, you know, you can agree to things like arbitration or, you know, so agree, say, we will handle any matters in Ulster County.
Yeah, I think, and that comes right back to the issue of education, educating landlords that you can put this in your leases and it will be binding. Okay, so what's the proposed amount, the proposed cap for deposit?
It's 200.
200.
I, just throwing a number out there with really nothing supporting it, but just a feeling, like, 500 sounds reasonable to me.
Are we talking about each individual, or are we talking about the lease total?
Let me first clarify something that I think is being misunderstood also. So, in deposit in the law is defined as any amount paid up front. It includes last month's rent or whatever.
Okay, so
and
the total for all of those?
Right, that's the only amount you'll be handing over. I don't know if I was asking another question.
So in my case, then I would, if I said if they signed the security, they gave the security when they signed the lease, and then they were supposed to pay the last month's rent, I wouldn't be allowed to. I would have to fall into a cap of $1,000 or whatever.
$200 apparently.
Or $200.
Yeah, that's. I think that's an unreasonable.
Wait, what is your scenario?
No, I'm saying before I said I collect security when they sign the lease, and then I ask for first and last. And you're saying I can't get last. Last is not just, you know, an allowable thing. It falls into the security deposit because it's paid up front, or it's paid before it's incurred.
Right.
So therefore, that would cap me at $1,000 to get 2 months, you know, the security and the last month's rent.
I was just saying it would cap you at $200.
Well, $200, yeah.
Can I be clear that 30 states, including Texas, limited that 1 month, and that includes last month's rent. So in 30 states, you could only collect 1 month's rent. That's evidence that it works in other places.
1 month's rent as the security, or just only one
month's rent?
That's
the only you can be paid up front. That's the only amount you can be paid up front.
So I couldn't ask for last month's rent then?
In Texas, you could. Well, and the other thing, so the way you're allowed to ask a tenant to stipulate where they can be served, and you can make it in Ulster County, so, but you could also, you know, have a co-signer. When I went to college, my deposit was $200, and we had a co-signer. You know, they might not want to show up, but their parents do. Or if they have an income, you could attach it to the income. You can sue tenants successfully if that is your goal, and if you take care of the people you rent to. We can't make a law that's going to accommodate every disaster situation.
Oh, I didn't mean to interrupt you. I was more just taking my place in line. So if you do have something.
I don't have anything else.
So the way I see it is co-signing. Why do people typically get co-signers? Because the institution or person doesn't feel like they have the credit worthiness to extend that opportunity.
Yeah.
But by banning credit checks, couldn't it maybe be taken a step further and be like, why would you need a co-signer then?
Well, yeah, I know that my first thought, if I knew I didn't have to have a credit check, would be, and if I could get my letters of recommendation, would be, I don't need a co-signer, I'm good.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think co-signers are something that's likely to go the way of the past.
I've had people offer. I enjoy it, and I tell the kids when they bring their parents to look at the house and rent with them, you know, to come with them when they're renting, I said I like that much better. Parents are involved. The kids know their parents are involved. And but the thing is that I've had the parents say, now, do you want me to sign the lease, or should Susie Q do it? And I'm like, no, she can do it. You know, I don't need the parents to sign. I don't do it that well. So. And I've had a good experience with it over 35 years.
Yeah.
I also have, I had someone in our office do research and they found 100 rentals in, I believe, Fort Myers area of Florida where the deposit is only 200 and that's all they collect. So this does work in other places. That's for other
rentals. And what do they do then if there is an issue where the rent isn't paid or there's any damages that need to be repaired?
They sue them.
But also cost of living is like so. It is.
The cost of living is very, very different in very different places even within New York State.
That's an expensive part of Florida.
And there's also the fact that the demographics of different areas are drastically different. You know, even between Ithaca and New Paltz, there's definitely a lot of commonalities, but there's also a big difference in the size of the municipality, the proportion of students to non-students. Because again, there are more colleges there, but some of them are smaller. And although there is like Cornell, but there it's also just a much bigger municipality, and like looking at the ratio of renters to non-renters can be different there. Same thing with Fort Myers. So it's not bad to look at these other communities as precedents, but we should know a little bit more about, well, how did they enact it? Like, was there any kind of initial humps that they had to get over? And just kind of more closely examine each of these communities instead of just like listing them. Because we could maybe even learn more things from them than just this particular thing.
It's a place to start to know where else it's happening.
Yeah, absolutely.
We would need to know more before understanding how it might affect us. Okay. I know whenever I've rented, the major casualty has always been the carpet.
Always is,
right? And
but if they remove that carpet, just like the hardwood floor, can you imagine?
And it would be so no.
It'd
and
be
that's,
a look nice in person.
You know, but there, I mean, if that's am I? Has that been your experience that your tenants have often done a number on the carpet?
I'm a horse of a different color. I don't, as I had said to Jacob on the phone, he said, "Well, do you keep money for cleaning if they don't clean?" I'm like, "No." And I don't end up with a lot of damages and stuff, and you know, little things that are damaged. And actually, carpeting, you try to have as little as possible, but it's normal wear and tear. And what I said to him on the phone was, I have been doing this for 35 years. If I were to keep every nickel I could get, I said, first of all, I have a lot more important things to do with my life than to make a checklist and then check it off all year long how I can keep $10 here, $15 there, and $100 there. I'm just not that kind of person. I'm not going to do it. And I said, also, you're going to have a horrible time renting your stuff out if the word gets around New Paltz that you are one of those landlords that abuse the system and keep the money.
No, I don't think so.
Not for new, yeah.
You
yeah,
have to understand that.
Then a new incoming freshman class comes in who doesn't know.
I came in, had no idea who the landlords were, and had moved in a situation that I probably shouldn't have accepted,
mm-hmm.
and eventually definitely got cheated at the end of the lease, and eventually got evicted for when the landlord didn't want to make repairs, and I didn't want to keep paying rent when the building was falling apart, so. There are the landlords out here who are doing that, and they know there's always that fresh crop of, and I'm so glad you're not one of them.
Well,
thank
I
you.
Am too. I wouldn't want to live with myself if I was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm just thinking, does a $200 cap mean that a landlord's going to perpetually be in small claims court? Or I like what you said about $500. I'm in this day and age, I would say $1,000. Would be reasonable if we're talking about $1,000 for the property, not $1,000 per tenant. You know, like, but are we? But that's not even the first and last month.
No, it's not.
That's just the security. I don't know. This is a tricky one.
It is a tricky one because I love the idea of keeping people in small claims. You know, especially people of modest income and access to legal services. But 200 is really low.
Well, the
solution is that they should just raise, because every once in a while they bump up the small claims.
Right, well,
yeah.
That's true.
Yeah,
in this day and age, that's a very
time
ridiculous
thing.
But you know, the thing about about the rent is raising the rent up. Why would a person, if I were a tenant, I would rather scrape up and get my ducks in a row and give you a larger security deposit, which I'm hoping to get back, rather than paying you an exorbitant and a bumped up amount of rent every month, so the landlord is being compensated for the fact that they don't have a security deposit, which you're not getting back. It's rent, you're not getting it back. The security deposit at a decent level, you have a hope that you're gonna get it back, and you have a recourse if you don't. Higher rent to offset and let the landlord stash it in the bank in case they have to replace the carpeting, you're never saying it, you're not getting it back.
There's no evidence that landlords raise rent when there's a cap on security deposit. There's zero evidence. There's a lot of evidence that that doesn't happen.
So just from a tenant perspective, just to throw this out there, many times upon entering and within the first few months of a lease, I kind of count my security deposit out, I'm not gonna lie. Just because, you know, I've lived in like 8 apartments and I've only gotten a security deposit back once.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
But I have never gotten a list of receipts. I've never gotten somebody to respond to me, you know, and then comes 4 months later and you're like, this is giving me ulcers, I need to move on with my life. Fine, whatever, I'll just like leave it. But I
just not paid my last month's rent. Instead, I'm using my security as my last month's rent.
Many people,
because I leave it usually cleaner than I found it.
I just think the faith in that mechanism is not very existent, because there are, you know, you seem like a great lady, Donna, but there are many landlords that you do have to think about, I need to protect myself, my financial interests. I don't fully believe or trust this person. Because like the house that I'm living in now, when me and my partner moved in, there were damages everywhere. And I knew for a fact, I was like, and I knew the people who lived there beforehand, we're not friends, but we're acquaintances. And they lost part of their security deposits, but yet my walls still had holes in them and they never got fixed. So from that moment on, I was like, say goodbye to the security deposit. You know, it's just gone. Because when, you know, you move into a place and there's a hole in the wall, and then the hole's still there to this day. And everybody, like a bunch of people from the previous year, never got their security. Like, what faith do I have? And that's not.
You know what, I'll go to devil's advocate for a moment, because I just suddenly thought, we have a lot of absentee landlords in this community. We have a lot of landlords who live in Florida or live wherever, and they hand over the responsibility to repairs to an agency of some sort. They might be getting billed for those repairs, and the repairs might not be getting done.
That's
and
fair.
So as far as they know, it was done. Mm-hmm. You know, well, so it might not be a landlord issue all the time.
At the end of the day, there still needs to be receipts to show
sure. These
were deducted, and if a, you know, a landlord is not being given those receipts by their agent,
yep. Then
it doesn't that lead the question of what's going on, what's happening, why am I paying you?
Yeah,
every apartment was 100% perfect. I don't know if I believe that.
Yeah, there are responsible landlords, there are very irresponsible landlords.
Yeah.
So the reason Kenny, is that your name?
Yeah,
the reason
you.
Kenny hasn't gotten his deposit back 7 out of 8 times is because there's currently no penalty on landlords for withholding a security deposit. If we put a penalty, which is what we should do, and I'm assuming we're going to do as reasonable people, it's going to be treble damages probably, because that's what other places have seen works. So
treble damages against the landlord.
Right. So that gives us a ceiling of what we can charge tenants as a deposit up front and expect them to be able to stay in small claims court.
When you explain it like that, it makes a lot more sense. It makes a lot more sense than what was on the paper. I get it now.
And I agree with you, Celeste, as well. I feel that some of these issues are overlooked because they don't have teeth. You know, there's there's not a lot of enforceability, accountability, you know, consequence. Consequence really, you know, determines people's behaviors. Like, if, you know, if there were no consequences to me, God knows what I would be doing right now.
Really?
Yeah, but
you
like,
would be wearing that tie.
I would be wearing that tie.
I'd be drunk on whiskey right now.
But accountability is really important, whether that's on the tenant or the landlord. I just oftentimes don't like with the landlords of my past that haven't been that great, I haven't seen accountability. It was like, what are you gonna do, you snot-nosed 22-year-olds?
Yes.
I'm not scared of you.
But I know they would do that to me even when I was like, eh, I'm almost 30.
But on the other hand, there are a lot of fraternities. there are a lot of groups of students, people I know personally, who, and not just students, but just people. Some of them are sadly in their 30s and still trashing apartments that they live in. So they're, and you know, a landlord could, you know, take them to court for damages, that kind of thing. I mean, that is something that the landlords can do. I just wish the math would work out a little bit better. It's really frustrating because it is.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess I would like to see if this is something that we were to endorse. I feel like we need some more. And like, I know you're saying that there's no evidence to suggest that this is going to negatively impact landlords. But if we could see evidence of the non-evidence, which I know is kind of like being like, can you squeeze water from a stone? but if some kinds of like data or information, or if some of the research could be shared showing like before and after in the communities that have adopted this very law, and like the years leading up to that and the years after that, to show that there was no detrimental effect on either group, tenants or landlords,
yeah,
this would be easier to sway. It would be easier to sway us, and it would certainly be easier to sway the public.
You know, it's a shame.
I think we want to do it, but we need to make sure that we're not hurting anybody accidentally.
Well, it's a shame that there can't be a joint law. I have something in here I'd seen in the paper, and I printed it up. It was in City of Newburgh has recently enacted a law, tenants responsibility law, and in it states, you know, I mean, how many times do I go into an apartment and the smoke detector is ripped down,
mm-hmm,
because, you know, it was going off from cigarette smoking that they're not supposed to be doing, or frying food or whatever, and I have to constantly pay to have it put back up again because nobody did it. And it's not worth, you know, $100 to go to court, so whatever. It's abusive by the tenant. A dirty plate, washing the kitchen floor.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is that in this law in Newburgh, it was very clearly stated that the tenants have to keep places clean. They can't have garbage. They were talking about a lot of apartment buildings in the hallways and in the backyards and building up here and there. And it's a shame that there can't be a joint law, that it's not here for tenants and here for landlords, that it's like, this is how we're going, this is a, landlord-tenant relationships is one thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's one pairing of people. And it really should be laws in a one document that says, you do this, you do that.
I agree.
So I think while we need evidence to show that it's not gonna harmfully affect, I think we can still, what we can do here is we can say, assuming there's no ill effects, what would we like the limit to be? And as far as going by property, what I'm concerned about is like, what, you know, the damages for a, so let's assume that it was $1,000 per property, which is the only way we could keep everyone in small claims court. Then that would also be, you know, if you're renting a studio, you have to pay $1,000. And if you're renting a 8-bedroom mansion, you have to pay $1,000. I would like to see something like, well, obviously I'd like to see $200. But if Kenny thinks 500 is a magic number, I would like to say $500 per person or $1,000, whichever is less.
What about 1 month's rent with a cap at $1,000? Well, I'm thinking that it addresses the issue of the studio. I think if the studio apartment is $750, then the person's putting down a security of $750,
mm-hmm,
because that's the month's rent. If the house is $1,500, then the person's putting down a deposit of $1,000 because that's the cap.
This can be our starting point.
That's a bit.
I like it.
Can we have a loose vote for $1,000 or 1 month's rent, whichever,
yes,
is higher?
I move that we vote for a security deposit of one month's rent or a cap of $1,000, whichever is 1 month's rent to a cap of $1,000.
All right.
Second.
Is there going to be a qualifier? Which is higher or lower? Or
no, no, the cap is by necessity.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
So.
Okay. Are we all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
I would like to say something. Take back all the mean stuff I said about your five people. I was wrong.
Oh, thank you.
Let's all be friends! Yay!
This is why we invited you.
Can I bring up a piggybacked issue that was mentioned a lot with the last one? So warranty of habitability issues,
yes.
I find to be a huge problem in this town. So we're not talking, you know, wear and tear, we're talking like serious health and safety concerns. So those, I feel like there isn't enough on the local level to address them, to, you know, highlight them and enforce them. Because while, so my dream is to someday be a lawyer, Celeste. I don't know if I'll ever be able to come up with the money for it, but so I just do it in my free time. But I've been looking a lot about, you know, village code when it comes to rentals. And even in my own home, I can see many deficits in that.
Kenny, I'm sorry. I just realized we put a major loophole in the last thing that we voted in.
Yeah.
I just want to hold you. Can you keep that thought for one second? Per property.
Right, per property. Yeah.
Per property,
right, okay.
Not per tenant. Sorry, please continue.
And most specifically, not having, you know, appropriate measures to deal with fires. Mold is a huge issue
yes.
as well.
Oh, God.
Roofing concerns have been a thing, which when it comes to roof issues, it always surprises me when it's not so clear cut. You know, it's not wear and tear that causes a roof to leak. Let's be honest. Usually
yeah.
tenants' actions have very little to do with it. It's just the weather, science, life.
No dance parties on the roof.
No
yeah.
dance parties on the roof. I am very for that. But I do believe that there are many apartments that if, you know, we walked in as a group, we'd be horrified that under current standards of health and safety laws, they're just not being upheld.
Yeah.
Well, I could probably show you one right now. I don't show.
Why aren't these properties being inspected? I'm inspected every single solitary year by the village
Let me talk you through what happened with my experience. This was many years ago. Sorry, I seem to have brought most of my cats to the meeting. So this was back in 2000. Living in a rented place, I'd been there about 5 years, and the ceiling began to leak. There was water damage in the ceiling. Carpenter bees eating the outside stairway. So it was, you know, big holes coming into it, mold beginning to show up, all the stuff, right? The property had been inspected every year by the landlord, not by building inspectors.
Oh no, sorry, go ahead.
Okay, and so I called the building inspectors in because I asked the landlord, you need to fix this stuff, but I'm not gonna pay your renting fees until you fix this stuff. And it wasn't getting done, so I called the building inspectors in to say, and they were like, this has to be fixed right away. It can't just be let to go. And I told the landlord this, and I was evicted. So I went to small claims court. The landlord brought a lawyer who showed me a piece of paper saying the landlord's not responsible for repairs. You know, it looked like it was a legal document.
Yeah.
Landlord's not responsible for repairs in buildings that have fewer than 3 units.
That's not real.
Well, how can that be?
I got scammed.
Oh, I'm very sorry.
So, and this is a landlord who still rents properties in the village now. So, yeah.
I know. And I think that it's like, I feel like it's
dealt with familiar, that. Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, a lot of these buildings, at least back then, weren't getting inspected by anybody other than the landlord. I don't know if the rules have changed since then.
I don't know, but I
so,
have had a situation where it's like I know that things were not up to code enough for it to be habitable for a person, and I know that for a fact. But the landlord was saying like this was inspected, this is what the person said, and blah blah blah, and I can provide you with all the paperwork. So I don't know what happens at that point. If there's like a legitimate person who I looked up who's like a, you know, a contractor of some sort or someone, or actually the person that she said that she called And then apparently, because I was thinking, I was like, oh, well, I don't know what, maybe they have like a special relationship. I don't know, money.
The only person that has the right to sign off on a property that it's passed inspection is the village building department.
How often does that have to happen?
Every single solitary year.
So just to point this out, the law does, as Dennis say, it has to be done annually, but it is very apparent that that is not exactly how it's done.
Not in my experience.
I have not heard any experiences, you know, growth experiences for before the yearly requirement. But, you know, that sounds to me more like an educational piece. When you educate people, if you're living somewhere and you don't think that it's right that you're living there, call the building department.
Yeah.
Brian will go in there like a bulldog.
I think there's a couple things going on. Part of it is with the changeover that happened, because there has been like turnover with the building department, and then there was like a city planner, and then they got fired, and now there's another one, and I'm not even sure who's in the building department right now, which I should find out. But anyway, so there's a couple things going on. One, I don't know about right this moment, there have been times when the building department was certainly understaffed. And some of those inspections were just basically, they would walk in, take a look around, check all the carbon monoxide detectors and the fire detectors, making sure that they were working, and then that would be it. So some of it was just that there weren't, some of the issues were not so like visible, like maybe there was like mold in a park place that was not easy to see. Or sometimes it was like, oh, well, they can't tell that there's squirrels in the walls, because all the holes where the squirrels are getting in are currently behind cupboards, and obviously they're not going to go snooping into cupboards in a building And so a lot of the time the landlord, sometimes the building inspector and landlord come in, they have to give you notice that they're inspecting, but you might not be there to helpfully point out
it was not
something. So sometimes it's just a lack of thoroughness because of being rushed, because there are a lot of rental properties, and at times there just wasn't enough staff people in the building department. Part of it was that just maybe some of those problems weren't like jumping out at the building inspectors. Or landlords being like, oh, hey, look at that shiny thing over here. Don't look over here. Or, you know, community standing in front of, like, I don't know, the cockroach party.
Yeah.
I don't know. So I think that, you know, and also there's the issue of unregistered apartments, that places that are not legally registered as rentals that are not getting yearly inspected.
I think that's the biggest
problem. And that's often where the most egregious, like, safety violations are. But there's also the issue of, on the previous council, we have one of our members, Ira, he got from the assessor's office and the building department, and I think he went to the town building department too for funsies, and the three documents did not completely match as far as like dates of who owned what and what were rental properties, what were not. And part of it might just be that those three entities update their records at different times, so that might have been just an issue that's out of sync as far as when they're kept up to date. Or there might have been just like, there might be misinformation and who knows what's going on, but those records do not completely match. And so that, you know, if the village assessor's office doesn't have the same information that the building department has, that could be problematic too. So these are all issues from the past. They may have been rectified by now, I don't know, but certainly it's a combination of these things, I would think.
So just to I guess more accurately say what I was talking about, so I have been dealing with the craziest housing situation, and I'll just leave it at that. But while, you know, attempting to protect myself, you know, I went to the building department, asked for the rental registry, the checklist, and the last inspection. But I was horrified to find out, when Holly was looking up all the information to print out for my partner, that before this year, that home hadn't been inspected in 6 years.
Wow.
And there's a lot of business, isn't it a big
it's a very big house.
And
it was
a legally registered apartment?
Yes, it was registered. Mm-hmm. But yeah, she like literally disclosed that it had been inspected for 6 years before that. It had been for this year, which I'm very happy to know that this year. But the reason that I was getting all those materials is because I wanted to see exactly how this building was judged. And, you know, I have, you know, a whole folder full of pictures of exposed electrical wires,
mm-hmm.
rusty nails, cords that are just, you know, put in, like, a very dangerous way. You know, like, you have a staircase going down, and then a giant cord, like, dipping and tied all around. You know, so it concerned me, and I already brought my concerns to, you know, Mayor Tim, because I just, you know, wanted to tell him that, but it really infuriated me when I heard that statement. Because I had the village code in front of me that says annually, and there is no misunderstanding of what annual means in my mind.
Can we jump back and finish security deposits? Because we're almost done there.
I thought we did it.
Yeah, well, I
wanted
to.
We didn't do travel damages, and there's one more proposal on it, and then we can just close the case.
Yeah, travel damages is the whole point.
Can I?
So we might as well pass.
Okay, so what's the thing that we need to do?
Can I ask you a question? When you said, how did you word it? You said a month's rent, $1,000 cap per property.
Per property.
Not
mm-hmm.
per tenant.
Right.
But when you have, I think it should be modified, and I think you're going to, because there are many, many people that have multiple leases in one property.
Well,
and
also
so there,
so could, should it be per lease?
I think it should be
no.
per lease.
No, because
right.
that, it's still
not
a small claims
board. Yeah, we're not talking about
no, no.
A lease where there's multiple signers.
Yeah, not
where
you
they
know.
All go as a shared, what was it, shared whatever?
Wait, I can
but,
explain this. So when they assess it, the assessor's office, so let's say you have like, I think it's like somewhere on Words Avenue, you have like 20 different apartments in the same thing. Those are assessed as separate properties. So,
yes.
So that counts as a property?
Yes, it counts as a property.
Right.
So,
trouble
damages.
So,
well, no,
wait,
that,
wait,
no,
wait,
I
no,
need
no,
to
no,
get
no.
my question answered first, because if you say, if you have a house that has an apartment that has three or four room bedrooms in it, mm-hmm. so you're renting out to three or four students or people, and each one has their own separate lease with their own separate signature page and their own separate amount of rent that they pay, That's who your entity should be. It should not be. You can't say
so
that the whole.
We're saying that under necessary parties, we.
But
so
wouldn't
they have
leases?
To be? No, they still have to be grouped together, even if they're done individually, because they have common questions of fact.
So well, that's
this
a broken law.
Well,
point.
That won't work then, because there's no way that anybody's going to stand still. It's just that's impossible. If I have an apartment with five people in it. And I'm collecting one month's rent for that apartment for those five people. First of all, who's paying it? They don't split up anything else, so there's no way that they should have to split that deposit five ways. So it needs to be per lease.
Oh,
it needs
saying.
To be per signed tenant.
Yeah,
then
you
can't
like
say
if
there's
small claims
in a building and they're.
Each one has their own lease, like $500 for rent, but that's what she's saying, that would get us
into the shared responsibility.
It has
I know,
to
but
they
either way, they
property.
Wouldn't be able to
that's
get small
they share common
over.
Property, correct? They
no.
like there's an apartment with four bedrooms, and they share a kitchen and they share a bathroom.
But
they
lease their own personal bedrooms.
Well, under
space.
This law, that would still fall under that you're talking about, yeah,
shared
because they
property.
Share a common area, so
well,
that's considered one property.
So. Right, but that security deposit is not going to fly because I need to collect something from each person that signs a lease.
It's not going to fly with you.
Well, hang on.
Or I am a minor player in New Paltz as far as landlords, and there's a lot of people people have multiple people in a house. Maybe some of them rent the whole house out for 30. I've seen it on off-campus housing. You know, $3,200 for this house. I go by room. Each person pays their own rent. And I tell them. You know, they say, "Do we sign them one lease for the apartment?" No, you sign the lease for your room, and then you are responsible for you. You're not responsible for what this one does.
So
this
okay,
does.
That's really common. Yeah, who's responsible for I'm sorry to cut you off, Kenny, but who's responsible for the living room? Who's responsible for
that's
the kitchen?
That's exactly
what
I was
going to
ask, is, you know, if there's a hole in the wall in the kitchen and every tenant says it wasn't me, who do you hold accountable then? You would probably take, you know, a little bit from everybody's security and say,
yes.
Well, you all had a responsibility.
Right,
so,
but if I'm only holding one... If I have five people that I'm dealing with in five separate bedrooms with a kitchen and the living room and whatever, and I only have one $500 amount of money to cover
well,
all of them,
it could be
$1,000. It doesn't matter. Right now, I take a month's rent from each one of them.
Right. So it would be a month's rent from each, but capped at $1,000.
Okay, that's fine.
The total would be capped at $1,000. Like the total of all the residents would be capped at $1,000.
You're going to get an argument on that.
There's going to be pushback on
yes.
that.
That's not, that is not fair. That is not sufficient money to be held.
Just some kind of provision, because so there's so many properties that have, like, the, you know, the 8-bedroom, 10-bedroom, 12-bedroom houses, but those are all separate units.
You know, each person, they're not in jeopardy of not being able to go to small claims court, because
Yes, they are. Yes, I'm telling you, they are.
No, they're not. If they pay $500 and, you know, they owe me a month's rent, that's $500.
But it's a shared responsibility piece where if they all are on the name of this one case, then the shared amount, if it's treble damages, would take it over $3,000 and then they go to county court.
But okay, but let's say room number three didn't pay her rent the last month she lived there. That's not shared anything, that's her.
But we're talking about damages that would be the common space.
Oh, you're just talking about damages?
We're talking about the security that is being held for damages.
Okay,
so,
but we didn't clarify that. You didn't say it was security for damages. Security goes towards unpaid rent and everything else.
Just to throw this out there, New York State does have a law that you can't recoup lost rent through security deposits without a court order. So you have to get a judge to find a favor that you were not paid rent, and then they decide that you can keep part of the security deposit. But New York State does have that regulation that you can't just arbitrarily say, well, you owed me that month's rent.
So,
absolutely, but the point is, if there is no security deposit to go and get through that process,
Exactly.
The landlord is left with holding the bag.
Well, I was just speaking about the, if tenant three doesn't pay their rent, the security deposit doesn't have to be how that is handled, because New York State says you can't just arbitrarily take security deposits for that.
Well,
so you would already be bringing tenant number three to court for lost rent, because you need to go to court to get the security deposit to be freed up.
All right, but okay. But the thing is that in how you formed that motion, it has nothing about that. That's fine with me. If I can collect $500 on an apartment for any potential damages, I don't care about that, because I don't usually charge for any little things that go on anyway, and I have good tenants. But the unpaid rent cannot be lumped into that.
So,
it
has to be.
So the landlord has no protection against anybody that wants to wreck their apartment and get
you,
walk
you
out.
You can
and
go
pay
to court, and you can get a court order, just the way tenants do. Otherwise, you could say, well, tenants have no protection. No, they can. They can go to court. And that's the same thing that landlords can do.
I think, like, at the core of this, it's putting the onus of responsibility on the landlord. Because, and in my mind, it makes sense. Because the landlord, they're running a business.
Mm-hmm.
The renter, the tenant, they need to live somewhere. You know, they're not looking to make money or a livelihood, you know. So I think just based on that, you know, the onus of responsibility should be on the landlord when it comes to recouping losses like this.
Maybe,
the risk of doing business.
Exactly.
I don't think so.
Possibly, but
the same time,
doing business fairly, I don't know, I'm of two minds on this. I could see it being the risk of doing business, but at the same time, why should the person who was not even in the building be responsible for the damage that was done to the building? That tenant should be responsible.
Exactly.
You should have fairly onus of the damage.
The landlord might be running it as a
business,
but the fact of the matter is that your job, are you asked to kick some of your salary into something that goes wrong in that business? And that's what you're asking the landlord to do. I'm running it as a business. Somebody punches my walls in. I am asked to kick in money and take money that we all agreed was a fair price for that room, just to live there with everything provided for them. But then they wreck it for some reason, or they have a party where a friend wrecks it, and I'm asked to take that money that's my income and pay for that.
No,
you're not asked
to
take your income and pay for anything at your job.
The problem is that we're focusing on all these hypotheticals of bad landlords and bad tenants, and that's not getting us anywhere.
Yes.
Well, but we're making rules that will apply and to situations that haven't happened yet. That's by nature hypothetical.
Oh, no, so. I'm just my piece. I think that the responsibility should be on the landlords, because it's a business enterprise that they're engaged in.
Do we get to re-vote? Because if I leave and then next meeting you re-vote on this a different way, I don't think that's fair.
The re-vote has to be called by the person who made the vote, who called the motion.
Who called the motion?
Robin. So she would have to be the one who called the vote, according to Robin.
Oh, it's 10 after 9. We have to wrap this up.
Oh, are we done? Kenny had his hand up.
The way that I see it is that, you know, if you owned like a local bakery and that bakery wasn't doing well, sometimes you would have to take into your own salary to, you know, support this business venture. And it just, you know, when I'm thinking about who would be best equipped to navigate the small claims process and really be able to effectively do it, it would have to be the landlord, because, you know, let's take like a career landlord, you know, they will know the process, they will have, you know, brought many people to court over their times and find a way to streamline it. You know, they'll have the form letter already in their computer to be able to give a cure or quit notice. They'll have, you know, the all the knowledge of past cases that they've worked on. So if anything, like the kind of like an economy to scales issue, you know, they are better equipped out of the two people in the relationship to have the burden of like small claims court on them. Students, you know, they move a lot, you know, might be their first time going through a court process. They might be scared of a court process, you know. So I feel as if it, you know, either way, somebody's gonna have to do work. Somebody's gonna feel like they are, you know, having to go through this motion, you know, either way, it's either the landlord or the tenant. I just think the landlords are often more qualified, capable, and have the resources to protect themselves better than students and young people and tenants.
I'm not thrilled with the analogy of the bakery cost of doing business, because we're not talking about, you know, the business not doing well, like people not showing up and taking part in the business. We're talking about somebody breaking into the bakery and stealing all the mm-hmm.
But they would still have to take,
you know,
that loss.
Yeah.
Maybe claim it through insurance, but
yeah, then there's the insurance thing. I think we need to take that one off the list until we can rediscuss it. But that's my thinking. I mean, it seems to me like it needs more discussion than we've put into it. So, but that's just my opinion. I'm willing to open that. We can't take it off unless we vote to take it off. So, right? Am I right with that?
Yes.
So I'm looking at you guys for feedback about whether or not to open that up again.
I'm not satisfied with it.
I think we should keep it.
Okay, but you're not part of the council.
You can make a
motion. Well, I can still say something.
Seconded, and then it can go to discussion, and then people can vote after that.
Okay, but we're closing out the meeting. Yeah, I'm just worried about time.
So is there a way that we can, you know, put a tack on that, and then
we can table it for we can take it off the list and table it for next week. Perfect for next.
That's acceptable right now.
Until the group collectively says, okay, this is our list and it's done.
Yes,
it's
not
a list.
It's in flux anyway.
So
it
doesn't matter. So it's all
tabled.
So it's all
tabled. Well, it's there and not going anywhere.
It's just a record. It's a record. Just before we motion or someone motions to adjourn, so I emailed it.
Thank you.
So I'm gonna lose this little steel. I just like just a handful of turmeric and raw garlic in my face every morning.
I do too when I'm like the sickest.
I'm sorry. but I sent a bunch of you educational, well, I sent you all the minutes that I had.
Yes.
On records from the last council, and also some educational materials that we had used. Our educational stuff from the last council. Some of it might need to be updated. I also sent you, I think the it's called Content for Something. And it's this pamphlet / booklet that the Village of New Paltz and SUNY had put together.
Mm-hmm.
And so I, like years ago, kind of put the two together because we'll have to duplicate information and updated it as best I could for now if I need to do it again. But the reason we never got to it is because the mayor at the time was proposing this legislation that might have affected what was going to be put into the booklet, so I held off on it, and then, you know, life happened.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something we can start discussing and see if any changes we might want to make or update it or improve it or whatever, which would be basically a nice comprehensive booklet about being a good tenant in the Village of New Paltz. Including just, like, helpful stuff like parking meters.
Yeah. I'll see if I can find the model that I found once before from one of the universities.
SUNY. I'll grab two to see if I can find that.
And also I've been meaning to. I know Austin has a Landlord-Tenant Relations Council, because this model is actually kind of designated by New York State, and I'm sure there's other communities in New York to have it too. We can kind of also just, you know, spy on them,
yeah,
what they've done and get some ideas from them.
Find the one that has the kitchen floor cleaning in it.
I know, right? Everyone likes that. Everyone likes that.
Make sure
the tenants
are bring it.
We'll clean the kitchen floor.
So one other thing before the motion adjourned, I mentioned earlier that there was also a joint meeting that I was hoping to get to.
Oh yeah, that did happen.
Based on the discussion, I chose to hang back. But,
thank you.
Sorry. Thank you so much.
Much
appreciated. So we are taking over the town.
To avoid it in the future, is there another Thursday that we can meet other than on the village calendar? I'm trying to bring it up now.
I think second Thursday was something that we were discussing, and everybody kind of liked the third Thursday better. Do we like to change which meeting?
Second Thursday, you'd have to be in the small room, and I wouldn't be able to clerk.
And we would be videotaped.
Yeah.
And for reasons like that, I'm really glad that we're being videoed.
Yes.
That's exactly why.
I mean, the progression was, it was good, it was hard, but we got to a good place, and that was really good.
Thank you to everybody for having to stand that. I invited her, so I will
Just keep you
I mean,
cool.
I invited her forever.
I used to.
Before we even
had a
whole plan,
she was going to show up. With a mentally ill woman.
And that's the point to move
this is why
that we, that we,
close.
What's the word? Close.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
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 I'm
like,
when did you send that? Was it soon after the last meeting? Like, was it within a week of the last meeting? With the stuff that you sent, was it within a week of the last meeting? Because it's like today I just went through, I'm like, oh God, like, maybe I'm going to send